Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. We are on to the fourth lecture on thermodynamics, and in today's class we will be talking about the work done in different thermodynamic processes. We have discussed four types of thermodynamic processes: isobaric, isochoric, isothermal and adiabatic. So we'll consider them one by one. So first we are taking isobaric process. Now what is isobaric process? It is that process in which the pressure remains constant. That means we will write P is constant, the pressure is constant. When we carry out the reaction, whatever process, we're trying to find out the work done at constant pressure. Let's see now what happens. We know the formula for the work done is, work done is equal to minus P external into delta V. Volume is changing, pressure is kept constant. So that means this formula we have to use. Whenever the pressure is not changing, we will be using this formula to calculate the work done. And in that, if it is expansion or it is contraction, we have already discussed in the previous videos, right? In case the pressure is not kept constant, then you are calculating the work done by the another formula. Then you are using this formula. This is equal to minus integration of that V2, V1 and pressure external here into dV. What is the change in the volume? This is the formula to be used only when the pressure is changing. In this case, it is not changing. It's isobaric process, so we will be talking only about this formula. Fine. Next, this is not changing. Second is isochoric process. Now, what is isochoric process? It is that process which is carried out at constant volume. Volume is kept constant in this case. Volume is not changing. Now, when the volume does not change, how we calculate the work done? We know the same formula we are going to use. Work is equal to minus P external into the change in the volume. This is not changing. Means delta V is zero. When delta V is zero, this part is zero, obviously the work done also will be zero. Work done in this case will be zero in isochoric process. Clear? Now, let's consider the another third type of the process, that is isothermal process. Now, isothermal process is that when the temperature is kept constant. So, isothermal process. Now, isothermal process we have studied in Boyle's law. Yes, Boyle's law. In this, we are keeping number of moles and temperature constant, and it gives you a relation between pressure and volume. Pressure is inversely proportional to volume. Or we also say that P into V is constant. Or if you have the conditions P1, V1, you'll have is equal to P2, V2. This is Boyle's law. So this formula, this will be required, you know, in calculating the isothermal. In isothermal process, we are focusing upon isothermal expansion. In isothermal expansion, what is the work done we are going to calculate? And in this, we will be calculating the work done in reversible and irreversible expansion. So, in this, under isothermal expansion, we are first considering reversible expansion. Isothermal reversible expansion. What is the work done in this process? We are going to calculate that. We'll try to get the formula. Okay. To get the formula for this, let us consider a vessel again, a cylinder. We are considering a cylinder. That cylinder is fitted with the piston. there is a piston here. And the walls of this vessel, these are perfectly conducting. These are perfectly conducting walls, right? Perfectly conducting walls. And inside this, we have taken gas. We have taken gas inside. There is ideal gas inside it. We have taken ideal gas inside it. Right. And inside this, there is a pressure, of course, exerted by the gas. Okay, this is the pressure of the gas. Here, from the top, there is external pressure acting on it. So, there is external, P external. That is the pressure external acting on it, on the piston. When we are talking about conducting, the whole thing is conducting. The walls and even the upper part, that is the piston. Now, on this piston, we keep very small, infinitesimally small, you know, weights we are keeping. Very, very small weights we are keeping. Now, in the beginning, internal pressure, that is the pressure of the gas, is equal to the pressure of the external pressure. Both are equal. But now suppose we remove one, you know, weight from here. We remove one weight from here. When we remove the weight from here, the pressure external will go down. Suppose slight change is there. Slightly it has decreased. Say now the pressure has become pre-external minus some dp. Some amount of the pressure has decreased. We have removed the weight. The pressure external has decreased. When this decreases, we can say overall the pressure exerted here has decreased. So in that aspect, we can have pressure of the gas is greater than the pressure external. The external pressure has decreased now by that dp. So this pressure has increased in comparison to the upper one. So we can say pressure external is greater than the pressure of, pressure of the gas is greater than the pressure external. Now we can also write like this, pressure of the gas is equal to the external pressure plus dp, plus the change in the pressure. So now when this has decreased, the weight we have removed, external pressure has decreased, the pressure here is comparatively more now and this will go up. The gas will expand. The gas will expand. And on expansion, the first thing, let us write, the gas will expand. There is expansion in the gas. Expansion in the gas occurs. Because here this has increased in comparison to the external pressure. When there is expansion in the gas, we can say that the gas becomes cool slightly. Always by expansion, there is a cooling effect. There is cooling effect on expansion. Suppose you take, you know, water on the hand and you just put it in, place your hand under fan, you'll get little cooling effect. So by expansion, there is cooling effect. So when there is cooling effect, this gas becomes cool comparatively because the wall is conducting, it will take heat from the surrounding. Okay, this will take heat from the surrounding and now this will start increasing the temperature inside will be comparatively now increasing. Initially, what we said, expansion occurs, the gas becomes cool. So when the temperature of the gas falls, it will try to absorb heat from the surroundings. It will try to maintain the temperature because it is isothermal expansion we are considering. So temperature here will again remain constant. As soon as there is temperature difference, it is going to take the heat from the surrounding and will try to maintain the temperature. Fine. Now, this has absorbed heat and the temperature again is balanced. It is isothermal process. So in this process, now when this has gone up, okay, it has gone up, right? So volume has increased slightly. When volume has increased, this pressure also will decrease. Again equilibrium will be achieved. This pressure, this weight has, we have removed the weight here, comparatively the pressure increases, pressure increases, so there is expansion in the gas. It gets cool again, it absorbs heat from here, and the temperature remains constant because it's isothermal process we are talking about. So when this is pushing the piston slightly up, volume increased. When volume increased, the pressure has to decrease as per the Boyle's law. So this pressure slightly decreases, again it becomes equal to the external pressure. Again, the gas pressure becomes equal to the external pressure. Now, let us find what is the work done. Now, definitely we know that the pressure is not remaining same. So, we cannot use the formula as work done is equal to minus P external into delta V. We will have to use this formula. This integration V2 V1 P external into dV. Okay, P external into dV. Why we wrote P external, not the pressure of the gas? Because when the volume increases, the pressure of the gas also decreases and it becomes equal to the external pressure. So instead of that pressure, we can write down the P external also. Fine. Now, this P external, we will have to change in terms of volume because we have to carry out the integration. So we will use the formula PV is equal to nRT. This formula we have to use. So if this is the formula PV is equal to nRT, what is pressure equal to? You will have nRT by V. So let us put instead of this pressure external nRT by V. So you will have this as minus, and you can have here this is minus, this is V2, this is V1. Instead of this, now I am writing nRT by V into dV. Right, I'm just please note it down. I will slightly push it upwards so that we can continue writing. Now, you have till here whatever things are constant, we will bring them out. So, we will bring this out as nRT. We will bring it out inside. You have V2, V1, and you're left over with dV by V. When you carry out the integration of this dV by V, what you get is log V to the base E. That means minus nRT log E to the base V. Right? This is V2 by V1. Now, this log V to the base E, we can convert it in terms of log to the base 10. If we have to convert this into log to the base 10, we will have to multiply it with 2.303. So, you'll have the formula minus 2.303 nRT log to the base 10 now V2 by V1. You have this formula. This is the work done for reversible isothermal expansion. Reversible isothermal expansion. This is the work done. Please note it down. And in case you are given volumes as P1 and P2. Then we know that P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. That is, pressure and volume are inversely related. So if that is the case, what we can write down for the formula for the work done in terms of the pressure, we can write like this. Work done, that is W, is equal to minus 2.303 nRT log P1 by P2. In terms of the pressure, we will write down as P1 by P2. In terms of the volume, it is V2 by V1. Okay. I hope this part is clear. We were doing, isothermal process. Yes. So, isothermal mein we have done reversible expansion. So, in exam when we are solving, we only require this formula. Okay. This formula, you can memorize it. So, this is one formula. In case volume is given and in case the pressure is given, you're going to use this one. Now we will be discussing irreversible isothermal expansion. Irreversible isothermal expansion. This also we will be discussing under two different headings. One, in vacuum. In vacuum, right? And the second one we'll be discussing is if the pressure is constant. Okay, so if the pressure is there, some constant pressure value is given, then what is the work done? If first we are calculating for vacuum. In vacuum, we say that there is free expansion of the gas, there is no external pressure. No external pressure. So when the pressure external is equal to zero in vacuum, obviously you know the formula is work is equal to minus P external into delta V. This is zero. The work done also will be zero. In vacuum, the work done will be zero. Now if we have some pressure given, which is kept constant, I mean this particular pressure, what is the work done in irreversible isothermal expansion, you will be using the formula, the same formula, this one, minus P external into delta V, into delta V. Whenever they are talking about the irreversible process, if it is irreversible process and the pressure is also not changing, you have to use this formula for calculating the work. Clear? Now moving on to the last process, that is adiabatic process, the work done in adiabatic process. In adiabatic process, one thing we know is that the heat change is not there. There is no heat change. So Q is zero. Okay, there is no change in heat. Right. For no heat change, which formula we have to use? Like in the isothermal, we were saying that P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. In this case, what we have to use is, we will have to use this formula, P1 V1 to the power gamma is equal to P2 V2 to the power gamma. This equation, this equation, it is called as Poisson's equation. Okay, so this formula we will be using in calculation, in calculating the work done. Okay, so if we are writing this, can we write that, PV to the power gamma is constant? You know what is gamma? We have discussed in the previous videos, that is telling us the atomicity, that is Cp by Cv ratio. Atomicity, if it is 1.66 gamma value, the atomicity is 1.4 diatomic. 1.3, triatomic. Well, it is polyatomic, right? So now this formula we will be using to calculate the work done. So in this adiabatic process also, we will have reversible and irreversible. First, we are taking for reversible expansion. Adiabatic, reversible expansion. Okay, so how we will be calculating the formula? We know the work is equal to minus, this is integration of V2 V1 P external dV. This formula we have, right? Now instead of P external, we will be using formula from here, right? So what we will be using? P external, now we have to convert it in terms of volume, because for dV, something volume should be there. So what we can write down here? We can write down P is equal to K by V to the power gamma. So that value we will write down instead of this P external. So you will have here minus integration of V2 by V1. Here you will have as KK some constant dV by V to the power gamma. Got it? Actually, we are not supposed to remember these derivations. Only the direct formula we require for, this work done. So this you can integrate, and you'll be having two formulas for the reversible adiabatic processes. See, one formula is P2 V2 minus P1 V1 by gamma minus 1. This is one formula for the work done. Okay, P1 V1 and P2 V2, we know that there's the K value. We said it is constant. This is one formula. In case it is given in terms of NR, that is a number of moles and universal gas constant, temperature, that is given, then you will be using the formula NR into T2 minus T1. T2 minus T1 by you'll have gamma minus 1. So there are two formulas which we can use for the adiabatic reversible expansion. Okay. Now, for in case you're asked to calculate the work done for irreversible expansion, adiabatic irreversible expansion, undoubtedly you have only one formula, that is work is equal to minus P external into the change in the volume. The change in the volume. This formula we have to use. I hope this is clear. Okay. Suppose you are given an adiabatic, the first one. Yes, I just did not mention the, you know, adiabatic process in case it is there. For reversible expansion, what figure you can make like we made in the previous one. You can have something like this. You can have a cylinder which is fitted with a piston. If it is representing the adiabatic process, you know, there will be gas inside it. And the whole wall will be insulated. It has to be perfectly insulated. Perfectly insulated walls. Only then we can say that there is no heat change. No heat change should be there with the surrounding. So with that, you will have the adiabatic expansion. Okay, the same way as we have done it for the isothermal. But for isothermal, the wall has to be conducting. For adiabatic, the wall has to be insulated. Now, in case you are, asked to draw a graph like this between pressure and volume for adiabatic and for isothermal, this is volume, this side you have pressure. So if what graph you get is that hyperbola, that's inversely proportional pressure volume. Suppose this is the graph for isothermal, and somewhat similar graph you get for adiabatic, but the slope is slightly different. This will be the slope. The slope for the adiabatic is slightly more. This is adiabatic. The lower one will be adiabatic. You can just see like this. This is adiabatic process. Say, this was like this slightly, and this is becoming like this. The angle has increased. This was the angle for, say, isothermal. And for adiabatic, the angle has increased. The slope has increased. So, slope is more for adiabatic process. Is this point clear? Now, what we have done here, I hope this part is clear. In adiabatic process, first we have calculated for reversible expansion the formula. There are two formulas required for that. One is in terms of the pressure volume. The another one is in terms of the number of moles, temperature, right? And insulated walls are must for that. And for irreversible adiabatic expansion, formula is this. If it is irreversible process, the formula has to be this. Work is equal to minus P external into delta V. And in case the graphs are to be compared for isothermal or adiabatic, then you will find that the slope of the adiabatic process is always greater than the slope of isothermal. Fine. So, please revise whatever we have done in the previous videos also, and the concepts which we have covered in this video. Okay. We will cover the next topics of thermodynamics in the upcoming videos. So, please till then work hard. Thank you.